Is Bitcoin actually as decentralized as we believe it is? Or, as some people like to claim, do a handful of parties control Bitcoin? Stick around, because in this video, I'm going to break it down, explain the argument as to why Bitcoin is centralized, and come to a conclusion that you can verify yourself. Hey there, everybody, Jonathan Levy, and welcome to this video. By the way, this video is sponsored by Voltage, but we're gonna talk about that a little bit later in the video. With the recent merge of the Ethereum blockchain and the switch to proof of stake, there has already been media coverage of how Ethereum has become even more centralized than it was before. And of course, the loyal meth head Ethereum devotees are already whining about how Bitcoin is centralized and Ethereum isn't decentralized and proof of stake is awesome and Vitalik is our savior and all that kind of stuff. One tweet particularly stood out to me. It is this one from Evan Van Ness. Out of the last 1,000 BTC blocks, 430 have been built by just Antpool and Foundry. So I wanted to take a minute and break this down and explain. I replied to Evan. We'll see. I'm sure my notifications are blowing up with a lot of very angry tweets. Yeah, we already got the angry tweets here from the BSV people, the Ethereum people. Yeah, people love to get angry on Twitter. I wanted to break this down and explain why this logic is flawed from a few different perspectives. First of all, 40% is not centralization, but Evan is correct in that three or so different mining pools do control more than 51% of the Bitcoin hash power. That is a simple fact. You can actually look at the latest blocks and you can see, I believe it is here, the breakdown of how many different blocks are mined. And you can see, yeah, Foundry USA has mined of the last 1,026 blocks, 272. Add in F2 pool, Via BTC, Binance pool, and Ant pool. And yeah, you're talking about 5 parties controlling about 75% of the hash power of Bitcoin. Now that's a big issue, right? I mean, that means that those people could coordinate and they could launch a 51% attack. It means that it would be so easy to take down those pools and destroy Bitcoin. Well, no, not really. And that's for a few different reasons. But the most important reason, and the one that I want to cover, is really explaining how a pool works. You see, when you mine Bitcoin, you have a very, 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 very infinitesimally small chance of actually mining a block yourself. What ultimately is going to happen is that you, with your one miner or even 100 miners, are probably never going to mine the actual block that works. You're instead going to be doing a lot of work for a lot of weeks or months or years, and that work is ultimately not going to find a block, which means you will go unrewarded. The solution that people have developed for this is creating mining pools, which means we pool together our hashing power and distribute the work of that mining pool across a bunch of different people's devices all over the world. What then happens is that when someone in our pool is the lucky person to find that block, we all split the rewards. It kind of works similar to like a copay insurance company where we all pay in, we all do the work, and if someone needs the money, they get the money. So it's this kind of collectivization of hash power. And what it does is it allows you to mine even if you don't have millions and millions of dollars to set up your own mining operation to guarantee that once in a while you will find a block. So first and foremost, in a way, mining pools increase decentralization because it means that I, even if I can only afford to buy one miner, can plug into this pool and start earning on my hash power, even if I have no chance of ever finding a block by myself. And that's a good segue into what I want to show you all, because yes, although there are these 5 different pools controlling a significant amount of the hash power, we can actually verify that they are within themselves distributed to a certain extent. Take, for example, the fact that many people claim, hey, you know, Ant pool and I think it's BTC.com or Via BTC, one of them, they're owned by the other one. It's like, well, whoa, that's a big concern. That's centralization, right? But we can actually go in and check these pools out and see just how decentralized they are. Now, of course, Anyone can set up any number of Bitcoin addresses. They could be doing a lot of work behind the scenes to hide the fact that it's one person who owns all these miners. But the fact of the matter is you can sign up and you can start mining for these pools and earn and see that at least you know that you are not part of this collusion, right? So we can go in and actually look, for example, at Foundry's address and see, okay, here they're getting paid out. They got paid out 50 BTC here. Not sure for what, because that's not a Coinbase transaction. But we can go and see, okay, where are the Coinbase transactions? Here we go. And we can see these newly generated coins. They got 7.6 Bitcoin, which is the 6.25 current block reward, plus the fees of that block. And we can see this is the address they are actively using to mine. And then we can just follow the money and see, okay, where are they paying these out? Well, yeah, sometimes they send a really big payment to one person who has a lot of hash power. We can assume that this is a miner. Maybe this is them paying their electric bills or transferring to an exchange. We could follow deeper and see. But we can also go and see that they have many transactions where they are paying out a lot of people. Take this, for example. This is a transaction that happened less than a month ago, and they are paying out a significant amount of people right here. And honestly, Foundry is one of the ones that I've been able to find less evidence of activity paying out people. But when you dig into some of the larger pools that people tend to participate in and join, for example, let's check out Ant Pool and just see where's the money going. We can click in and we can see that they have received 3401 Bitcoin and they've paid pretty much all of that out. They're not keeping money in this address. And we can see right here, they paid out 168 other people. So either they're doing a lot of work to obscure the fact that Ant Pool is a centralized entity, or they have at least 168 different companies and individuals all over just in this one pool who requested a withdrawal and got their payout. Now, that was on 5/23. That was a pretty long time ago. But we can go through and just see all their history and where the money's going. And we can also see that, yeah, they switch addresses once in a while. They use a new address from time to time, but we know all the addresses. So we can go in and we can see what are the addresses that they are using more frequently and how many different people are they paying out. Now, Ant Pool is a little trickier than some of the other ones because they are constantly changing out their addresses. But like I said, this is all public on the blockchain and we can see all the addresses that they've used from 2017 and on. If we go into, say, F2 pool, we can see that they have three different addresses. We can look and see their most recent one, and we can check and just see. I mean, this is today. I'm recording this on the 18th. We can see all the coins that they've earned, all the coins that they continue to earn, what their balance is, and go down and just figure out how many people have they been paying. Where is the money going? We have to do a lot of scrolling here because a lot of this is the Coinbase coins coming in. Tons of Coinbase coins coming in. They're finding blocks, you know, every couple hours, this pool. So very, very successful pool. But we can see that they are paying out. And that money is going somewhere and it is going to a lot of different people. Let's find an example. And we can even see, you know, that they're transferring to some other address pretty frequently, and then we can just follow that money and see where it goes. So if you ever have any questions about how centralized, I mean, the pools usually don't publish exactly how many people are participating in the pool, but you can just look and follow the trail of the money and see, you know, via BTC. Let's have a look and see who they are paying out. And we can look at this block and we can see the address that they paid to. And we can just follow the money and see that they're paying 5 Bitcoin to this address and 5 Bitcoin to that one. And here you've got a ton of outputs that they're paying. So yeah, of course, mining does lend itself to larger, more centralized operations, such as building big warehouses with really, really close and easy access to cheap power. That's just the nature of how mining works. But that doesn't mean that it's centralized. It doesn't mean that all these people are one entity. And the most important point that I want to draw is these people in a second can switch their mining power, their hash rate, to another provider just like that if they feel that something fishy is going on. They are not locked into that pool, and although a pool temporarily behaves as one actor, they can move to any pool at any point in time or form a new pool, meaning that they are not really one centralized, unified body in the way that they behave. And by the way, this is just for Bitcoin on-chain. This doesn't even consider the fact that Lightning Network is significantly more decentralized than Bitcoin itself, because Lightning Network doesn't use mining. It uses very simple hardware and a simple Bitcoin node to route transactions from person to person to person, with over 20,000 Lightning nodes set up right now. And that brings me to today's sponsor, which is Voltage. You've all heard me talk many, many times before about why you should be running your own node, even if you're not running a Bitcoin business. And yeah, I do support you running a node at home with your very own hardware, such as a Raspberry Pi. In fact, even Voltage told me that they're very much in favor of you running your own node at home. So if you're a simple at-home user, this may not be for you. But if you are looking to build on Bitcoin, build on Lightning Network, or accept Bitcoin in your business or commercial activities, well, a Raspberry Pi is really not gonna cut it. If you don't believe me, just go and try to book a paid coaching call with me on my website and realize that half the time, the Tor proxy, reverse proxy thing on my Raspberry Pi fails, and I end up having to send people a manual address instead of them using BTC Pay from my Raspberry Pi. So if you're looking to build something on Bitcoin, whether it's just to try out developing for Lightning or actually setting your business up to accept Bitcoin at scale, I highly recommend that you check out Voltage. Voltage is different from so many other providers such as OpenNode or BitPay because they allow you to set up your very own node that only you control. This means that you can set up apps with one click, develop, customize, and ultimately control and custody your own funds with no man in the middle. Best of all, Voltage runs on enterprise-grade hardware, which means your node will be fast and reliable, and they have no access to your Bitcoin or any of the data on your node. To go ahead and set up your very own Voltage node with just one click, go ahead and check them out using the link below in the description or visit voltage.cloud. So that's all for today's video, and I want to thank you all for watching. Let me know in the comments below if you learned something from this video, and I would love if you just take a quick moment to subscribe to the channel. It does make a really, really huge difference and helps support the channel so we can continue putting out great educational content. Thanks so much, and happy hodling.